would like to welcome all of you, in spite of the slight confusion at the entrance, to the whatever number session it is of the Architecture Society. And it's the 44th, is it? Well, it's a wonder that we've gone so long. For those who are, I mean, mostly I see familiar faces, but for those who are coming for the first time, just a brief introduction to the fact that this program is treated by the India Habitat Center as a cultural event. And the idea was that it was a forum for architects to be able to communicate with their victims, if you like, or with their clientele, and perhaps achieve a better understanding of what it means to provide an architectural service. And of course, it started off as a kind of talk shop between architects long time ago, when it was not called Architecture Society. And it was called the Architecture Collegium, which was a forum for architects to exchange their complaints with each other behind closed doors, and to worry about what was all going wrong with the fact that they couldn't get enough work, or they were not respected enough, etc., etc. There are a lot of gripes we have. But then later it got transformed into, people said that we must have other disciplines, and after that it became something that I felt that somehow architects must communicate with their constituency. And unless that's the only way for architects to gain respect in society, and also to gain respect amongst themselves, that they feel that they're doing something worthwhile. I mean, the test of what we do is really in our clients. Clients is not the right word. In our beneficiaries, that's also a wrong word. But people we work for and we work with. So with that brief introduction, now I have great pleasure to introduce our speaker for this evening, Madhav Raman, who is a practicing architect and a teacher from time to time, and a kind of impresario. He has been doing quite a lot to introduce architecture to a larger audience, and has been noticed for his facility to enliven architectural events in the last few years. So it's very nice of him to come and spend the evening with us today. And I'll ask him therefore to present his talk, and I'll come and go in.
Good evening. Thank you, Professor Ganju, for the kind introduction and perhaps a qualification that I don't know whether I deserve. But I will try and keep you enlivened if I can, because it is a 45-minute talk I've been asked to give you. And when I am on the other side after about half an hour, usually my patience wears thin. Having said that, it's a great pleasure and an honor to be here. Greha, to me, since its inception, from what I've known and what I've been involved with Professor Ganju on this, for this platform, one could call it, is actually the nature of the platform, to my mind, is collegiate. And in a collegiate environment, it is actually appropriate not to discuss one's work in a sort of a comparative environment, because, I mean, that's what architects usually tend to do. Whenever architects are asked to speak, they usually speak through their work, and therefore you'll see a bunch of buildings. But strictly under instructions from Professor Ganju, I am not going to share any of my work. And when I say my, I'm actually referring to my practice's work, and that's Anagram Architects. My partner, Webhav, is sitting in the corner. I'm happy to have him here. He usually doesn't come for my talks. Anagram was set up, he and I started off right after college in 2001. And from 2001 to 2019, it's been 18 years. So Anagram is good to vote. And because Anagram is good to vote, it's also appropriate that Anagram should have some sense of what it's been doing for the past 18 years. So what I want to talk about today is actually to try and put together a bunch of notes about what we've seen happen in the past 18 years around us in the city of Delhi, in the region of Mewat or North India, as you might call it. And I want to just share that with you in a kind of an open-ended manner. This is not going to be a talk with a purpose at the end of it, but it is more going to be to try and tell you where we are and what we are thinking and what we have learnt in the past 18 years. So I've called it, it's a mouthful, Transects through the interstices of architecture, and that's essentially because how we were taught architecture and a bulk of how we are told we are to practice architecture is it falls into the notion of architecture as making buildings and buildings themselves getting treated as objects. The interstices refers to the spaces between architecture, the spaces that I have discovered within my practice. And transects is a kind of throwback to what architects do. We like to cut sections through things. Transects is not a section because technically a section is a drawing. Transects refers to a slice, and in this particular case, it refers to slices through time. So there's a component of time, there's a component of space in this talk. So I'd like you to kind of stay with me along those two tracks. So how did we start? We first met in 1996. A lot has changed, particularly my hairstyle. And Vaibhav hasn't changed much, as you can see. He and I started off Anagram more than anything else, just on the basis of our friendship. There was no philosophical underpinnings to why we started our practice. We just felt we worked really well together in our last final years in college, and we decided that if we didn't embark upon this kind of partnership together at that point in time, we wouldn't ever see each other again. He'd go back to Jaipur, which was his hometown then, and I'd go back to Chennai, where my parents stay. A lot has changed in the world around us. When we were in joint college, the only real form of entertainment was Doordarshan. When we were children, Doordarshan would, you know, broadcast only for a few hours in a day. And then Star TV exploded in our lives somewhere early, just when we joined college. And now today we find ourselves where we've morphed into a situation where we are kind of consuming media content through our cell phones. And therefore, I thought this transect through how media has evolved would be an interesting way to kind of capture our times, because so much of what we do and say now involves the media. And where do we find ourselves today? Oh, I'm sorry, I think there's a contrast problem, but let me read that out. So if I were to cut a transect through our time today, I feel that we are post-globalized. Globalization seems to have gone through a cycle, and it seems to now being politically and economically, there are across the world, a lot of positions that are adverse to globalization, but we are post-globalized. So one can't deny the networks that existed from colonial times till date that created globalization, and we are now rest with the vestiges of that. One primary vestige of globalization is connectivity. And so we are post-globalized, but we are hyper-connected. The third outfall of globalization, and the reason why I make a point about globalization is that in 1992, we liberalized our economy, and from there set forth a ball rolling that in 2001 actually came to bear, where we had this whole experience of what globalization means socially, not just economically. The third outfall is unfortunately the one that faces us in its most dire avatar, and that is that we are climate changed. I think arguments on whether we are actually in changed climate are now have been well and truly put to bed. Whether that is anthropogenic, it's been created by man, is also, by and large, sensible people would believe that it is. So this is the condition that we find ourselves in. A lot hasn't changed. So in 2001, when we started practice, there was something in place called the Kyoto Protocol. That was a global kind of agreement facilitated by the UN Forum for Climate Change, UNFCCC, to try and cut down on emissions and to try and cut down global gases, greenhouse gases globally. And so the Kyoto Protocol was put into place, 135 countries signed up, and George Bush pulled out because he felt that the controls that America would face for cutting down on emissions would result in a drop in economic growth for that country. Sounds familiar? COP21 happened in 2015 in Paris, and precisely the same argument was rolled out when Donald Trump pulled out of the COP. Another thing happened in 2001. In 2001, there was about post-liberalization for about a decade or so. There was terrible, terrible air pollution in Delhi. For those of you who remember, even then, the Supreme Court needed to be active or activated before anything got done. And they actually stamped down and insisted that all public transport in Delhi would convert from diesel to CNG. Just like today, when the Supreme Court, when we have an active judiciary that does take things like the current air quality problem in Delhi very, very seriously, there are political and social protests against such moves, based again on this thing of economic parity, whether a change like that would affect the economics of this city, of this country, so on and so forth. 2001 was also a year of incredible natural calamity. Globally, of course, in Australia, like last year, there were, like very recently, there were wildfires that they call Black Christmas wildfires, where 1.2 million hectares of forest burnt down. Closer home, there was, of course, the Bhuj earthquake, where entire towns were flattened. It wasn't a very good year for architecture. There was a lot of buildings that were lost. Buildings were lost in 2001 for other reasons, for man-made reasons. There were anthropogenic calamities. This is an aerial photograph of the collapse of the Twin Towers in New York on 9/11/2001. This idea of whether calamities are natural or man-made is what climate change is problematizing. Whether it is a devastating flood in Kerala, or whether it is forest fires in America and Australia, whether there are snowstorms in Northern Europe, it's now becoming more and more difficult to draw the line between whether something is man-made or human-caused or anthropogenic, or whether it is truly natural and outside our control. We also hit a very important milestone in 2001 as a nation. We became a billion strong. When I say a billion strong, it sounds very impressive. Many economists look at that salivating, really, literally, at their mouth, because it 1 billion strong population means that big and market and that much consumption, and therefore that much economic growth. But in India's context, 1 billion has a very different position, and that is a 1 billion population that needs to be clothed, fed, housed, and usefully employed in order to be able to extract themselves from their economic conditions, social conditions, so on and so forth. If you look at, these are photographs from NASA. There's been a lot of political debate on the electrification of India and whether we are 100% electrified, or whether it's electrifying. The debate itself is electrifying, but and raises passions very high. But these are the images that are used for those political arguments. And if you look at what's happening around India, you'll notice that most places, their nightlights show up as urban settlements with very, very dark patches in the hinterland. Many of those hinterlands that you see around India, that is especially Tibet, Iran, the Sindh Plateau, these are all uninhabitable. So in contrast, much like the bad contrast that these lights and the projection come together to not show you clearly what my images are, that contrast seems to show up. Yeah, maybe we can. Could you ask him to just kill the lights in the hall? Sare band kar dijiye. Sorry, yeah. But on closer inspection, you notice that it's not, it's more diffuse. Development in India is kind of spread across. And yes, it is that our villages are electrified. They're not living in darkness anymore. But you will also notice that the lights are a bluer tinge, because a lot of those settlements in the hinterland in India are under cultivation or under forest cover or are non-urban. And I think the distinction in India between this binary between rural and urban is very ill-conceived, because I don't think that definition is so stark like it is in much of the first world. Here there are kind of a sliding scale from extremely primitive, I wouldn't even call them rural, settlements or even nomadic settlements, and it works its way all the way up to the massive urban sprawl that makes up the Delhi NCR region, which today stands, I think, at the second largest urban agglomeration in the world, second to Tokyo. So you can see that very clearly in the night lights. What you will see, if I can point out with my marker, is that is Delhi, and that down there is Bombay. And you can see a string of cities, except this patch in Rajasthan, where there is no connectivity. But this is today a space and a land that is heavily sought. It's something that is going to be the, say, the karm bhumi, if you like, for what future development in India is going to be about. And it's something that being an architect or being anyone or even an informed citizen, one can't not know about these plans. In 2008, the government of India set up what's called the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, or conceived of it. And it's an interesting story what caused it in 2008, was that until 2008, a bulk of our iron ore was being exported to Japan and was fueling the consumption of that market. 2008, the demand shifted from Japan to China because China was hosting the Olympics in 2008, and they needed a lot of iron to build the infrastructure they needed to put in place to host those Olympics in the scale at which they did. And they therefore, and that gap, that demand was met by the Indian iron ore suppliers. And this kind of evacuation of iron ore from the Japanese market led the Japanese government to approach the Indian government with this idea of creating a freight corridor from Delhi to Mumbai that would in effect bring raw material and resources onto the freight corridor. And while the material moved along the freight corridor, they would get processed. So by the time the material reached Bombay, it would be ready for export. So DMIC is conceived as a series of special economic zones that are strung along this corridor from Delhi through Rajasthan, and it affects the states of, I mean, you can see that Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra, and Madhya Pradesh. The stretch of DMIC is 1,500 kilometers. Its width, the active SEZ width, is going to be about 200 kilometers. So put together, that area is actually more than the area of the state of Haryana. So in effect, this corporation, the DMIC corporation, is going to control land in this country, and special economic zones have legislation that empowers the entity that is in charge of those SEZs to take decisions along the SEZ for export purposes. Their tariffs are different, the laws and legislations and even civic law in these specialities are vastly different from what we are used to in normal, democratic, urban or rural India. It's an important thing to conceive, to kind of set in one's head when one is looking towards the future, because this is scheduled to reach fruition by 2030. By all good things Indian Standard Time, this might get delayed by a decade perhaps, but definitely by 2040, we're looking at the DMIC being completely implemented. The idea is that the 24 new cities, smart is what we are told they will be, are going to accommodate the bulk of the brunt of the urbanization that one is seeing happen in India. If one zooms in further, so if you look along the side, I've listed three development zones that they've created around the city of Delhi. One is called the Dadri Noida Ghaziabad zone that stretches from Delhi through Uttar Pradesh all the way up to Uttarakhand, the foothills of the Himalayas. The southwest of Delhi has the Manesar Bawal area, development area. And further south towards Jaipur is the Hushera Bhiwadi Neemrana zone. Now these have been planned, and that's a slide of what the Shahjahanpur Neemrana Behrod urban complex that has been planned between Behrod and Jaipur looks like. And as you can see, it's a six-lane expressway that stretches those 1,500 kilometers from Delhi to Mumbai. And along the way, there are urban sprouts. These are the new cities and developments that are planned along this. If you pay attention, you'll see a lot of these orange blobs in the middle. Those are actually villages. And the gray hatch around them are have been zoned out as future expansion. And this brings me to the kind of city making that is being envisaged at the DMIC. Although I would want to criticize it as being newfangled and therefore non-applicable, I'm forced to admit that there is nothing different with how the DMIC is planning its cities than how cities have been planned in this country for goodly 100 years or so, I'd say. And I'll try and explain that to you and put that in perspective. But this, to me, is where the critical problem between urban India and rural India lies. The sort of kettling in of rural settlements, which gets tsunami-like swamped by urbanism, and it kind of gets trapped. Because a lot of us, if you are residents of Delhi, you will know if someone asks you where you're from, you never say you're from Delhi. I like to say that because I never identified with my home, so-called hometown Chennai, because I grew up in Delhi. But mostly people refer to their hometowns, and eventually they refer to their home villages. A bulk of India recognizes, identifies itself with that sort of spatial geographical context. And what happens when these villages get kettled by a city development is that the most problematic, to my mind, is that vast swaths of the Indian population lose their sense of identity, being linked to the land and being linked to a very specific geography. This was a study that students I had been kind of guiding in their seminar in 2010 had produced. This was looking at how urban villages in Delhi over time get included within the city of Delhi. And as you can see, what happens is first an urban village is identified, a village is identified for urbanization, it's put on notice, and a lal dora is marked around that village. In the time that it takes to actually develop the area around the village into the city, which is takes anywhere up to 10 years, a lot of the unclaimed or unsettled or land that doesn't have clear titles get actually speculatively usurped by land sharks and speculators in the real estate business. And so you see the village kind of expand into what's referred to very comically as the extended Lal Dora. And then after that, by the time the city does arrive, what you get is a ring road around such, or a fencing away of these villages. So not only do these erstwhile agriculturalists lose their agricultural land and their whole sense of pride from what they do in terms of being agriculturalists gets completely severed, literally they get compressed and ghettoized into these kind of kettled ghettos, which then degenerate because the Lal Dora prevents them from being acknowledged as being part of the city. These villages then tend to house first-time migrants into the city from very, very vast cultural and economic contexts. That's what the city of Delhi looks like. I love Delhi. I know it sounds a little corny to say that on a public platform. It's more in vogue to say what the problems with Delhi are. and yes, Delhi does have many, many very, very severe crisis level problems, but there is a certain beauty to the city, and I think a lot of it comes from its historicity. And its historicity, while is most apparent from the monuments and the archaeology almost that one sees around us, it's actually in the fact that the spatiality of Delhi, with its the historicity in the spatiality of Delhi, is what creates its character. So I'd like to now take you through very quickly what is the history of city making in Delhi. So I'll start with pre-1857, because 1857, like economic liberalization, I feel was a very sharp point or inflection point in the history of the city, because 1857 saw the first revolt, organized revolt against British hegemony in this country, and that led to a lot, very drastic change in how urban planning saw the city and how colonial powers actually saw city making in colonies, and which is what we have received as a legacy. So Shahjahanabad, if you notice, it's not changed too much, other than a few dish antennas that have come up, but the texture and fabric of Shahjahanabad remains. It is clusters of, there's a street-based urbanism, there's clustering according to production. These range from the old karkhanas from the time of Shahjahan to, markets that deal in the latest electronics goods. And of course, this idea of iconic placemaking. We are not a country, and we're definitely not a city of large plazas where people gather express their solidarity as being civic citizens. So it's for the lack of that whenever we feel we need to protest, we go and protest at India Gate, which is truly a memorial for the unknown soldiers who've lost their lives in the defense of the colonial project and the independent country. So to feel that that in somehow kind of holds our identity, even if one is not hyper-nationalist, even if one were hyper-nationalist, there is a certain problem in that, I think, that that's the only kind of public space that we have, because for us, public spaces in this subcontinent, actually the most democratic public space that we have is our streets, and it's not plazas, not certain designated areas where one can gather. So public space was a shared and precious resource. There were identity anchors all sprawled out throughout Shah Jahanabad. These were havelis that would identify precincts, chalks, maybe a temple, a mosque, a gurdwara, or a police station, a kotwali. These identified specific precincts within Shah Jahanabad. And therefore, because of the, between that and the clusters for production, there was a lot of emphasis on community, and city making at its core was community built and community driven. When the city of Old Delhi, Shah Jahanabad, expanded outside its fortifications, which it was a fortified, compact city, when it sprawled out into the suburbs, the planning and the building of those suburbs were actually given to guilds of traders who would develop their own neighborhoods. So all that we see outside Pahadganj, Karolbagh, all those have actually been professional guilds that have developed those to suit their own kind of communal requirements from those spaces. The emperor never told anyone how they should build cities. Then of course comes post 1857, this idea of the white town. We've got our own white town, that's Latin's Delhi. For the first time in India, cities started emerging out of fortification, became an open plan city. The idea that because you're a colonial power, all the land that you see is unendingly, endlessly available to you to do as you deem fit is an attitude that unfortunately continues today. So the revolt resulted in this idea that you needed to segregate to create security. The rulers needed to rule from distance. So there was a very stark distinction between Latin's Delhi and Shah Jahanabad in terms of its urban form. And of course, after 1857, the British really invested in developing a bureaucracy because they felt they needed intermediaries between the populace and themselves in order to translate and to help better, they say administer, but I would say better exploit what the country offered to them. There were other historic things that happened, provision. So urban planning came into being, and that came in through the idea of health and sanitation. There was a handbook of town planning, city improvement boards and legislation. This is true both in Europe and in India. It almost happened simultaneously because of the germ theory that had taken root at that time. So this emphasis that cities needed to be kept hygienic and healthy and quality of life needed to be maintained at a certain benchmark. But in order to do so, you have Calcutta came up with a town improvement board in 1847. Bombay came up with one in 1898. Mysore Improvement Act came out in 1903. These are all more than 100 years back. And of course, they relied on something called eminent domain. That is, if the government chooses to acquire a piece of land or acquire a resource for what it feels is the benefit or the larger good of the entity that it is administering, it is willy-nilly capable of doing that without any protest possible, democratic or otherwise. And of course, the processes that were put into place started this whole kind of system of sanctions and permissions, which very often architects claim to find themselves shackled with and justify shortcuts because they feel that these are very ungainly and not suitable to the, let's say, their creative minds. So public health being the kind of cornerstone of this form of urbanism. And of course, with Latian's Delhi came this idea of new form. There was predictable geometry. It's interesting, there's a lot been written about how the urban form of Shah Jahanabad almost indicated a dangerous heathen maze. It's almost like the natives would collude and conspire to attack and ambush the British because of the kind of labyrinthine networks of streets that Shah Jahanabad had. They could ambush British residents and then disappear into the night. And so to kind of prevent that from happening in Latin's Delhi, a predictable sort of geometry. This idea of a low density sprawl was activated by the Land Acquisition Act then 1898, not the current version that we have. And this idea of privatizing open spaces, so private gardens, gardens attached to bungalows, boundary walls, little spikes and spearheads on top of boundary walls, this came into the vocabulary of what even now continues to divide or segregate our cities. Pomp and ceremony, can't be a colonial power without a little bit of jazz. So, you know, large, wide vistas which would allow processions of elephants and camels and natives in their finery doing march pass and saluting solar-topied British administrators was much in vogue, and it continues to have a certain attraction to the powers that be today. And in essence, it creates socio-fugal spaces, and these, by that I mean urban spaces meant to segregate, separate, keep away from each other, a complete antithesis of what the old city is. Post-independence, we started looking towards ourselves as a rational metropolis because we were doing away with all these shackles of culture and superstition and vastu and nonsense, and we hired the best the French had to offer. Corbusier, he was invited and designed Chandigarh as a benchmark of how new cities should be built in newly independent countries. There was also a lot of assertion of state authority. There were development controls, stipulated volumetrics, and this idea of the iconic capital complex. From then till Naya Raipur, the first thing that gets built in city after city after city is the capital complex. It's this assertion of state power that starts a city, literally, before anything else. It's not schools, it's not colleges, it's not even a sanitation system. It's literally your high court, your legislative assembly, and so on and so forth. Well, rational as it is, it makes land parcels, it segregates based on land use, not in based on community. It segregates and it keeps away. There were locations downwind assigned to where the industry to be, where industrial zone should be in Chandigarh. Today, those are the areas that are being developed for malls. So things change, but this idea of separation, the completely aspirational notion that we would become a country of cars was set in place when Chandigarh was designed. We've given up our cities to cars, and Delhi is the prime example worldwide of how you can lose an entire city to a four-wheeled whatnot. And this idea of a setting back, because of this emphasis on rationality, health, sanitation, buildings stepped away from streets. Streets were unclean, streets were noisy, streets were polluted, homes were sanitized, homes were cool, homes were calm, homes had inner courtyards maybe. Sometimes if you wanted a little more space without telling anyone, you could cover that inner courtyard, get yourself another room. No one would know because from the outside no one could tell. Liberalization happened in 1991 and immediately set in place was this kind of explosive growth across all cities and specifically in Delhi. There was unprecedented urban growth. There was this idea of the urban entrepreneurial urban migrant. People stopped coming to cities after they got jobs. They came to city hunting for opportunities because liberalization made that promise that if you come to a city post-liberalization, you could make your buck. You could ensure that you and your family were extracted from rural poverty. And with that came this emergence, political emergence by that I mean, of the middle class. It's interesting, in a later slide I'll explain to you exactly how powerful our middle class is. But literally the city makers couldn't keep up. This boom was so large, so overwhelming, that master plans creaked and fell away. Lethargic urban planning, I'd say, because it didn't keep up with the kind of changes it needed to make. We had 20-year, we still do have 20-year master plans. I mean, literally, from when I started practice till now, we've had the same master plan apply in Delhi. And the city is obviously not in tune with that kind of planning. Master plans themselves, because of the bureaucracy and the expertise required, were so opaque that regular folk couldn't understand what was happening in a master plan. Forget regular folk. I would guarantee you 70% or 75% of architects in Delhi do not even refer to the master plan. Bylaws makes their head spin. They'd much rather hire what we politely call a liaisoning person to deal with such sanctions. And it is this kind of lack of enthusiasm on the part of practitioners of spatial planning and spatial design to engage with their own given rule book is one of the biggest cop-outs that our collective professions have done to this country. And development controls kept becoming more and more complex, because once you have this framework, all you do is tweak till that handle that you're tweaking with comes off in your hand, you throw it away and then wait and see what happens. So there are two forms of city making that are now in place. One is the formal top-down planned. So what you see on the left is the sub-city of Dwarka. It's DDA's success story of how they can actually execute an extension to the city on their own and do it effectively and create space for the urban migrants and growing urban populations. And on the right, you see what is actually about 85% of the city, which is self-constructed, self-planned, on the edge of legality, well and truly informal, and completely unhelped either by architects or by government. A good example, I like to show this slide because it gives you, it's so dramatic. This is a satellite photo of the edge between Sainik Farms and Sangam Vihar. So what you see on the left is Sainik Farms, what you see on the right is Sangam Vihar. A lot of the construction material that builds the farmhouses of Sainik Farms comes from Sangam Vihar, a lot of the labor comes from Sangam Vihar, but they have to sneak into the Sainik Farms because they're not allowed into Sainik Farms. So this is in 2001. Dry, dusty. If you look, you'll see a kind of grid in Sangam Vihar as well. It's not chaos. It's fairly well organized. It's organized essentially communally. So there may be a slum lord who decides how the land is divided up. Large tracts of these are agricultural land officially, including Sainik Farms. And it's divided up through mutual agreement, or more and more, if someone owns a large piece of land in Sangam Vihar, they release land into the market as and when they have requirement for money. This is completely informal. I must admit, a large part of Delhi's land dealings are completely illegal, but that shouldn't come as a surprise to anyone. It's something that no one really wants to talk about, because cleaning it up requires all of us, including architects, to change very basic elements of how they practice design, and that's a little scary to do. So let's have some fun. This is 2016, this is today. So as we really congratulated ourselves as being one of the countries that is contributing to the green cover of the globe, we are well and truly deserved of that congratulations. But let's look at the occupation of these spaces. So Sangam Vihar does not have the luxury of green. Sainik Farms does, not only luxury of green, but also the luxury of swimming pools. Sangam Vihar has a severe water crisis. It's amazing that you have swimming pools and community taps located literally within 50 meters of each other. I'll zoom in to explain, to kind of give you a sense of how this densifies. So left Sangam Vihar, left Sainik Farms, right Sangam Vihar. 2001, that's 2018. So the informal city naturally performs to the kind of performing levels that we expect the formal city to perform to. But the formal city is indulgent. It indulges itself. We do not forget about keeping a track on what our consumption levels are or our waste production levels are. We do not conserve land. We do not appreciate in the formal city land for its socio-cultural and economic significance. Dadri, Noida, Ghaziabad. This is the slide I'd showed you earlier. So from the city of Delhi down here, all the way past Muzaffarnagar, Meerut, this is the edge of the Himalayas. At the edge of the Himalayas, and that's what, without that gray that looks so nice and well-planned, that's what that landscape looks like. That trickle down the center is the Yamuna. This area is historically called the Doab, or the two river land of two rivers. Southwest of Delhi, reaching into Haryana, Western UP, is a larger area or geography that has traditionally been referred to as Mewat. Mewat no longer appears in any urban planning, urban design lexicon. There's no way that the residents, the original residents of this landscape or this geography, have any way of holding on to what their identity linked to that land comes from. So closer to the foothills of Himalayas, is one of our prime natural resources, and that is the Corbett National Park. And what you see at the edge of the Himalayas is quite shocking. That as urban development pushes against villages, villages that have traditionally been agriculture-based, and rural incomes that rely on cyclical forms of agriculture are forced now to eat into what is protected natural forest. And one sees examples of this all across Corbett. Now, this has been traditionally done. Usually, it's slash and burn agriculture. But when it was done at a low intensity, at times it was perhaps helpful to the forest itself. It helped it rejuvenate and regrow. But when it's done at the pace and intensity at which it's done now, it's actually hugely detrimental. So what happens is that this is what a prime forest in the lower hills of Uttarakhand looks like. It's deciduous, it's temperate, it's warm, it's wet. Over time, agriculture kind of denudes that. It cuts terraces into it. You have terrace farmings on the lower hills. It's exposed, therefore, to the vagaries of the flash floods that the river does, river periodically goes through. Every monsoon wipes off the topsoil. As every monsoon takes off the topsoil, the agricultural productivity of this land drops drastically. So the kind of cash crops that were grown earlier soak out the nutrients. There's nothing that's possible to grow, and it becomes a grassland. When it becomes a grassland, it starts looking like this. And when developers from Delhi visit the edge of Corbett, they look at this, and to them it is paradise. And to them it is a place where they can use this to create resorts. They're called eco-resorts. My own firm has done one at the very edge of Corbett. This is in fact a site photo of that. That's what it looks like in the monsoons. So you can see that with every monsoon rain, there is a wash-off that happens off this land. And it ends up looking like this. Great for eco-resort, bad for forest. What happens is that with every summer, this grass completely burns up, dries up. And because of that, it's a tinderbox. And in April and May, 1 month, 2016, Uttarakhand saw 1,395 wild forest fires. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is one of the biggest contributors to the bad air quality that is in Delhi throughout the year. We talk about crop, rice paddy stubble burning. That is true. That does contribute hugely. In fact, to levels that are comparable to the what was called the Black Christmas fires of Australia. Those are the pollution levels where it goes beyond 999 on PM2.5. But the constant bad air quality, like with traffic, comes from things like this. Very quickly, I'll take you through. Our population today has gone up from 1 billion to 1.34 billion. That's the Indian income pyramid. It's 0.5%, which is your high income group, 2.5%, which is your middle class, your great Indian aspirational middle income group. Cumulatively, they amount to 3% of our population. All the architects in this country service exactly 3% of this population of our population. The bulk 97 is not serviced by architects. It's not serviced by urban planners. It is willy-nilly left to its own devices. Let's look at GDP. So we have 60% of our GDP coming out of services. We have 18% coming out of agriculture. And that's because essentially the way agriculture happens in this country, it's not the kind that helps drive economic growth. It's subsistence largely, and it's small land holdings. These are not the scales at which you'll see agriculture contribute vastly. Yet, we are still amongst the biggest exporters of a lot of agricultural produce. The Green Revolution is a double-edged sword. We upped our productivity, but a bulk of that productivity is actually being exported. It's not feeding mouths in this country. 24% is industry, and there's an informal GDP. Now, post-demonetization, we've come to understand the informal economy as being the illegal economy, and that is completely untrue. The informal economy are that 97% people feeding themselves using cash transactions, keeping self-corrected ledgers of who owes how much money. Benami is one of the primary ways of ledger keeping, which is now illegal, but that was how we traditionally transfer money from one person to another. And it's a medieval practice that's borrowed from the Arabs, but it continues to stray in large parts of South Asia and the Middle East. So 100%. So actually what we have on record in terms of what people pay tax and what we can put on record as contributing to our GDP of 169 lakh crore rupees, that scale of amount of money is actually hidden. And estimates are that it's at 50%. So this pyramid, which I like making, architects like making pyramids, you see another pyramid which is completely anonymous, completely unknown. Employment. So we need right now 45 million jobs, but equally there are 45 million jobs that are in place. So we have a 50% employment problem, unemployment problem right now. And if you look at our employment pyramid, that's what it looks like. So 90% of that 47% of India's population that's employed in agriculture, 90% of it is informal. It's cash based. And it's something that is not, you can't ignore it. And the fallout of demonetization is testimony to just that fact, that you cannot ignore this. This is the biggest data that India needs to face up to. So that 97 that I'm referring to, which is your, what we call the EWS and your lower income groups, this is, these two slides, these two images represent what is the biggest crisis in their life right now. It's access to clean clean water and access to good quality sanitation. These are two missing ingredients to qualify to basic quality of life. Without these, it's impossible to get out of poverty. Forget subsidies, forget basic income. If you don't have these two, you cannot improve your standard of living to the extent that you can get out of poverty. But, and there's the other problem is access to energy or electricity. Now that is something that I think the government of India, thanks to their commitment to the COP21 in Paris, now is taking on solar electrification on a war footing. And therefore, decentralized production of electricity can give hope to that 97 that they may actually end up accessing some form of energy. And it is apparent now more and more. We see and read more and more of these stories happening across the country. The other great thing about the 97 is that they're great entrepreneurs. Even the poorest of the poor is looking to get out of poverty. They're looking to be upwardly mobile. That's not the case in most countries. It is only in India that you have this severe need to improve the life of your next generation and perhaps even the generation after that. There are only people in India who plan that far. No one else thinks of that far down the generational divide. And this is what we do. We use our public spaces for pedal. And the combination of these three gives our cities the vibrant street economy, the vibrant street culture that we all have and deserve and need to sustain if we need to keep that 97 employed and at least on this side of quality of life. Because they're entrepreneurial, that 97% of India's population has lapped up technology. It's incredible. It's one of those amazing stories across the world of how India has taken to cell phone technology and mobile technology. We use it to network. We use it to keep in touch with people, with relatives in cities. We use it to entertain ourselves. And we also use it to create content. And to my mind, this is the big pot of gold that 97 sits on. It has the ability now through technology to be a voice, to get itself heard. Unfortunately, it is now dumbed down thanks to WhatsApp and our over-reliance on only passively receiving information rather than putting out information as we know it. And it gets used to kind of argue on political positions. But literally, this is what can, in the future, become something that helps 97% of our population. To that end, now that I'm talking about technology, I'm a first-generation urban migrant. Digital migrant, all this talk of urbanism. That means that when I grew up, I didn't have access to a computer. But somewhere when I was around 15, I think, 15, is when my father brought home a PC. And being the youngest, I was naturally supposed to be the expert at computers because I'd taken computer class in school. But it was a love affair that started around then, and it still persists. I am a geek, and I do keep up with what's happening in technology. And this is what I want to talk to you about. Past 2 years, actually from 2009, the world has been taken up by bitcoins. And past 2 years, it's been there in mainstream media, and people are talking about it in a really excited way, and you see prices of this going up, and you're saying, is this an alternative currency? Will this be the mana that takes us out to, makes the world a more equal place, takes the money away from the Lehman Brothers, and so on and so forth? And it was started by this anonymous guy called Satoshi Nakamoto. And when he tweeted his last tweet, because after that he's disappeared, people say he may have died, no one knows. He tweeted saying, WikiLeaks has kicked the hornet's nest and the swarm is headed towards us. You see, until that time, bitcoins and blockchain as a technology was something that only geeks talked about online. You win a game, you get a bitcoin. You solve someone's problem, you get another bitcoin. It was this kind of fairy tale world away from reality where people were just keeping each other happy by giving them rewards of these bitcoins that they mined, and it had kind of like Lord of the Ring references and, you know, very stuff geeks like. So, but what happened after WikiLeaks started accepting money in bitcoin? Suddenly, information and a new form of currency came together. And the lack of information and the idea that you can crack open information and change the world got associated with this form of currency that was completely bizarre, completely alien to how we understand banking. But what it is, and I'm sure many of you now know, in the past 1 year, we've got a lot of knowledge and a lot of education on this front, is that traditional banking systems are centralized, bitcoins is decentralized. That is, if a bank earns profit because of the ledgers it keeps about what it's doing with your money and what you're doing with it, the bitcoin relies on blockchain technology that does it on a peer-to-peer basis. So there are many, many ledgers used by many, many people that are constantly updated, and you don't need the bank anymore. So the banks are frightened, because now you're wondering, why do we need a bank? But forget the banks. Let's start looking about thinking about land, thinking about land management, thinking about land deals, thinking about corruption. And suppose you have ledgers that are always resolved without any third party needing to mediate. That information is open. Open source information is always going to create a more equal platform. There is no information asymmetry anymore. So a distributed blockchain ledger system is actually better in order to keep information transparent and available constantly and constantly verified. So to end, this is my thesis, that when I joined college in 96, until that point of time, we were relying on this country being driven and powered by a public distribution system. That is, the government would have control of all resources, it would decide how it should be distributed, and we would passively accept that. After liberalization, we went into a PPP system, a public-private partnership, where private individuals were allowed to participate in the development of this country. Allowed, may I say. And that allowance was through a license or through a designation that you are a partner with the government, and therefore you can also take advantage of the kinds of eminent domain that the government is used to. So today, post-liberalization, we're moving from a PPP to what I like to call a P2P. I haven't coined that, it's peer-to-peer, it's classic techno geek talk for people trusting in each other, especially people whom you consider your peers. And that, I think, is a interesting thought. It's an interesting thought to discover trust again in the environment that we are in. And if we trust our peers, how far can we extend that peer in a peer group, in a democratic society? Do we consider our peer group to be communal? Do we consider it to be economic? Or do we consider it to be a citizenry? I'd like to end it here. Thank you very much.
Informative and rather thoughtful talk. The floor is now open for questions and discussion, and there'll be some roving mics, I think, which will be given to those who want to ask questions or discuss something, make observations. But please identify yourself before you begin. And I think Madhav is, I mean, it'll take a few minutes to recover from
from extent.
I'll just join you on this table simply to moderate. It's called to
well,
luckily Professor Ganju has allowed as much time as I have spoken for you guys to speak back. So we can wait.
Tell us who you are, and then a mic, please. We will get recording.
So, just as an afterthought, I'm Shivangi, and I'm a student of architecture. And just as an afterthought, how would P2P translate in planning field, or would it dissolve the field of planning?
Yeah.
Like the scope of the field.
When will the robots come? Okay. Look, I think this is a fundamental problem of paranoia that we all face as professionals in this country, whether it's lawyers, doctors, chartered accountants, architects, what have you. We are constantly fearing the fact that we are not relevant, and when will we get replaced? Will we disappear? And what's the impact of this onslaught of technology, globalization, post-globalization? What are we going to do? We're not going to know what's going to happen tomorrow. And I think the fundamental cause for that is we are essentially locating ourselves servicing only 3% of this population. In any democratic country, if you are relevant to 3%, you might as well just go home. So I think the primary thing that we all need to look at individually as practitioners, professionally within organizations, as advisors to government, as what have you, whatever role we can play, is how we need to think through individually and collectively, how do we address that 97%. I mean, even if we consider addressing the middle class in its entirety, it would be a huge step forward. Right now, we do not cater to more than 5% of this population, truly, as architects or as planners. So what does this mean? How does P2P translate? It comes from that idea of trust, and it comes from that idea of whom you consider your peer. Okay, I can only speak about architecture because I'm not a planner, but architects look for patrons in this country. We don't look for clients, really. We look for patrons. And we're not really satisfied with our clients. We usually gripe about them. I think a lot of what Professor Ganju was saying, Greha was up to earlier, was griping about clients. And that deep sense of dissatisfaction can change if we expand our peer group to include at least, say, 50% of that 70% income group that we call the lower income group. If that is the case, how do they hire us and how do we service them? I think technologically it's now possible. You see, the kind of architecture that is required to service 97% of this population is not elaborate. It's not complicated. It's not complex. It's very, very simple architecture that is purposed to look at what this cultural expression that architecture should have as much as it is to improve quality of life. These are, to my mind, architecture projects that you would do in your second year. That's the level at which we need to operate. And we need to operate at that level without looking for patronage. And the internet is, and this peer-to-peer networks that the information technology revolution enables, does help that. Because if I were to be able to download a simple drawing of how my house should be organized, if I've got a 25 square meter plot in Sangam Vihar, if someone could just come and tell me, okay, this is how you do it, put your kitchen here, ensure that your toilet shafts and pipes are organized in this manner and that manner, and these things today can be technological, I mean, the technology exists to kind of upload and download these things. You can charge 1 rupee per plan, and I'm sure the kind of market that this opens up, you'd be richer than the richest architect.
So, two questions, but I think they're connected now. Are cities or anything possible without the will of authority? Like, would they become...
Without the will of the people or the will of the authority?
Authority.
Oh, okay. Like, I thought we do everything on the will of the authority. Okay.
Yeah, but then, when we're talking about the way ahead or a possibility of peer-to-peer, where does accountability go? Like,
how do you mean?
This is essentially a network. Like, the network expands or dissolves. It gets seeded deeper into people, right? in a distribution system, at least you know where it comes from.
Yeah.
Like, you could challenge it, or there is a system.
But there's no reason why P2P needs to be anonymous. It's just that because P2P started off with, sorry.
No, that was okay.
So P2P started essentially to take over when the music industry was faced with a copyright issue, and people exchanging music is what started P2P, and various P2P networks are based on that technology. It needed to be anonymous then, because if someone knew who was selling pirated music, they would get arrested. It doesn't need to be anonymous. It's got nothing to do with that. And from that lack of anonymity and openness in transaction, if one looks at the parallel technology that goes into building blockchains, that kind of openness and knowing is how you will keep it accountable. You will know the architect who's designed your house or the person who's designed the product. Right now, they are anonymous. I don't know who's designed the DDA flats in Vasant Kunj. I have no idea. I don't know who's designed any kind of top-down Prime Minister Awas Yojana. Forget that. Kidwai Nagar. Who do you know who's designed Kidwai Nagar? I don't know who's designed Kidwai Nagar. It's a Shapurji, Palonji, NBCC. That sort of is what is credited with designing it. So I think the future is actually more accountable.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Aditya. I'm an architect, practicing architect. When you are saying that 97% of the population haven't been affected or been served by the formal architect, right? But I mean, they have been in a certain way, right? That the processes which we have defined, the construction processes, for example, concrete. You see concrete in the remotest and remotest part of this country, which is probably a top-down effect, like concrete being practiced in some structures, which is not part of this country. I have gone down to the rural areas, gone down to the poorest of poor, right? Replacing probably their technologies and what they were working on,
yeah.
Right? So this is kind of developing a process. So when we are thinking about working for those people, is the
sorry, I have one slide show. Sorry.
Yeah. So when we are saying that, you know, we are working for those people, so is the process, you know, defining the process is the more democratic way of doing it, or rather than defining the outcome?
Okay. So I'd like to correct you. I don't think architects introduced concrete to this country in the scale at which it's happened. It's actually engineers. And it's infrastructural development. People see dams and bridges being made out of concrete, and eventually even the petty contractor realizes, okay, these are the advantages of it, and therefore you get bad quality concrete, because it's not supervised concreting, and concrete as a technology is very technically intensive. The way it's rolled out in this country is rolled out in the sort of manner in which you would roll out, say, mud fuska, you know, with that kind of quality control. So I think that's the key, that as architects, what is the kind of technologies that we deploy, especially in non-urban contexts? So to what extent do we caricaturize, or do we get inspired by, or do we actually take forward well-established tectonics and building technologies and ways of building that exist in more traditional environments? I think that for me, the key as a practitioner is that, yes, my process has to undergo a change, essentially because without changing that process, I can't cater to, because the process I have in place right now in design or executing a project is actually attuned to the financial stamina of the top 0.5% of this population. It's not attuned to the financial stamina of the 97. So I need to change my process to be able to do that. And also in terms of the product that I'm creating, I know it's uncool for architects to call buildings products, but if you can call them objects, you might as well call them products. If that product, in the nature in which it's put together, the kind of lifestyle and the kind of cultural context it provides its user, is empathetic to their cultural context or their economic context, then I think we would be making progress in actually having impact, in actually catering to more than the 3%, and in actually becoming more relevant, and therefore, you know, if the authorities are willing to destroy a building that we all hold very dear and we wonder why no one listens to us. It's because it's not that 0.5% also equally doesn't care about that building, it's only us. So we need to make buildings that, 97 care about, and then Bob's your uncle.
When we are saying that we are making buildings, right, is it necessary for architects to only identify themselves as making and final product?
No, not at all, I don't.
Right, I mean, because it's more about setting the techniques, the process, because that goes longer than, you know, like a single product.
It's a bit of an I'm undecided. I don't know what we contribute the most to is process, or we kind of lead the way in finding expressions of architecture that are new and are capture zeitgeist and capture the imperatives of the economy at that point in time. Or are we trying to plan processes that will last us for 100 years, for 20 years, for 5 years, for 2 years? I'm very unclear on that. All I know is that there has to be a sea change in how architecture is practiced here. If we feel we are irrelevant, then I think we need to do that to ourselves for our own benefit and our own survival.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, Madhav. Thanks for this refreshing course today. Refresher's course, not refreshing course. Some things I knew before, I think I've forgotten, I've started noting them down again. As we all know that most of the things we are getting built these days are for profit. Sometime years back, maybe there are some things which are not getting built for profit, from private profit. I was wondering, how do we ensure public good from this private money which are spent for a purpose?
Okay, I'd love to say bitcoins, but I'm not going to. Okay, I think a good way of looking at this is to look at how Jio has completely changed the internet telephony market in this country in the span of a year. I think Jio, because of the financial clout of the Reliance Group, has been able to take cell phone technology to a price point that it's not a price point that is impossible. It is a price point that is well before its time. So while other service providers are still trying to rake in profits and saying that, okay, we'll keep making it cheaper and cheaper, but let's stagger that so that we can get more and more money out of it. Jio has said, look, you know what? I feel that if I can start giving cell phone connections at 4G speeds to everyone, then even if they're going to give me 1 rupee for that, I'm still much richer than that 3%. I think that realization for a corporate to make is astute, but it's also usually heartless, ruthless, right? I think if that realization comes to individual practitioners who are steeped in their own context of practice, I think then it can have an effect that will be for public good. We need to see our own financial incomes coming from that 97%. We need to create practices that allow for that to happen. So, yeah, that's how I'd respond.
Yeah, so I'm Anindya. It was a wonderful presentation. What I wanted to ask was, how do you plan to bridge the gap between the two ideas that you presented? One, catering to the need of 97%, and then you speak of the technological advancements, as say Bitcoins. Now, if Bitcoins do come into play for a bank...
Sorry, I was using Bitcoin as an example. I'm actually talking about blockchains. Yeah.
I'm just taking the example of Bitcoins. Say Bitcoin does come into play on a larger scale, and we talk of a banking institution, say JP Morgan. Now, when Bitcoin starts recruiting human resources, it's only the top 10% of the JP Morgan sector that can actually shift into the Bitcoin setup. Somebody who's a canteen manager at JP Morgan isn't essentially going to land up at a Bitcoin firm. And every time there's a technological advancement, the human resource size only gets lower. It gets crunched. So then, are we not increasing the 97% to 98, rather than actually catering to the 97 when we move towards such technological advancements.
So specifically, you're talking about Bitcoin and that technology behind it, blockchains, right? So actually, no, because blockchains rely on hardware much more than individual expertise or technological prowess, software prowess. It's actually pure hardware. You need machines of a certain type, of a certain capacity. It needs to be backed up with power of a certain type and a certain capacity. Yes, for Bitcoins, because of the speculative rush that Bitcoins has seen, this is skyrocketed. So, in fact, Weber will back me up. 4 years back, I was trying to convince him that we should start. So I was looking at all the computers in office, and I was saying that at night when you go through sleep, we should make this a Bitcoin farm. And so, because clients weren't paying us. So when the boom was beginning, I was thinking about doing this. It felt so bizarre as an architect. I mean, and Weber quite rightly said, "Tu building banana, ye kya kar rahe?" So the thing is that it is technically not something that you need expertise. You need hardware. Now you may say yes, but then who can afford that hardware? The thing is that if the world shifts away from fossil fuels in its entirety, you will find energy prices drop very, very drastically. To the extent, and equally processing powers of computer chips will keep increasing in speed. So the size and of the battery and the size of the device you need to actually do blockchain work, what they call mining, right? They call it Bitcoin mining, but even blockchains need to be processed, right? So that processing work can actually fit into the palm of your hand. Now it's up to the private providers of this technology at what price point they're willing to release that into the market. And eventually, with cell phone technology, it's clear that the consumption is key. So if the technology is consumed, the price of manufacturing at scale can actually drastically drop. So regardless of how expensive your Apple iPhone costs today in your hand, it's actually significantly cheaper to produce. So I think that to answer your question, I don't think it'll become 98%. It could, if those policies are in place. And I think if as a society we can move towards, so one big thing is to keep the internet free and to keep information on the independent internet free. So that's something geeks fought for and won with the government here, this current government. But it's moves like that that one needs to keep an eye out for and to try and protect society against collectively.
Is it okay to come up with a follow-up question?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think I couldn't come up with immense clarity what I wanted to ask you.
Sure.
Like my basic question was you answered. Like when you go off in the night, you can actually mine, but you can't really open a bank branch in your office in the night. So the human resource part is what I'm concerned about. When Bitcoin comes into play, someone who's an architect by the day can actually start
mining blockchains.
Yes.
I think you need to, okay, so I'm not a big fan of Bitcoins as such. I think that potentially it has that kind of WhatsApp effect on life. That so cool you can't get off it. It's like a drug. So I think that let's keep aside Bitcoins, okay? Let's just look at blockchains. You'd be interested to know that a lot of banks who fear their extinction are now rapidly transferring their information onto blockchain, their processes onto blockchain technology. That means that they're willing to reduce their human resources in order to get blockchains in place. Andhra Pradesh is now taking its land records and making them blockchain so that anyone can, through RTI, know who owns each and every parcel of land in Andhra Pradesh. So these, I mean, I don't know to what end they will be successful, but considering a lot of the techies come from that state, if there is a state in this country that can pull it off, it's probably Andhra Pradesh. So I think these are the ways in which one can try and see how blockchain technology makes sense for contexts in India. And specifically to try and get that bottom quarter or 20-25% out of extreme poverty to move into the lower income group, and to try and get that lower income group basic abilities like assets in their hands, their ability to ensure that their kids go to good schools, to have good quality medical attention available. These are all things that can be resolved through Bitcoins and through blockchains. And finally, the perfect example is the kinds of aggregation one is seeing through various apps now beyond Uber. Uber was the star aggregator, but now you find aggregations of services. So Urban Clap is a way in which a version of Urban Clap, which doesn't cater to the middle income group, but if it caters to the lower income group, could also work equally well. If you knew where you could get the nearest doctor, could the doctor come to you? Could you do a WhatsApp call? If you could get teaching modules supplied to you on your cell phone, and that cell phone costs you only 1,000 rupees, I think it's possible.
Am I audible? Yeah.
Yeah.
My name is Anagha, and I'm a historian, actually. So my question will slightly change towards your, throughout your presentation, you also spanned through, from actually pre-1857 till today. And I was wondering, in the context of changing space and time that you presented, how do you see the change in perception of space among people and architects, and how has that changed in terms of construction practices, actually?
Could you repeat the middle part of your question? What, how has it changed the construction process?
But construction process based on the change in perception of spaces, you know, because
over time. Change in perception of spaces over time, or over
maybe in your practicing career, like in last 18 years, how do you notice a change in perception of space among people, architects specifically?
Well, I can tell you something from an inflection point that I realized had taken place about, I think in, I'd say about 2012 or so. That was the beginning when Gurgaon's real estate bubble really burst. Right, and around 2012 to 2014 is when India truly felt the impact of global recession. So 2008 we were fine, 2012 onwards we started saying, oh, it's stagnating, and in the construction industry that was the paramount thing. And I thought, oh yeah, these are cyclical, right? So there's construction boom, then there's this, and it'll go up, it'll come down, it's all because of speculation. But till date we haven't recovered. I think that has to do with this perception of space and land. It's this idea that if I were in the early to mid 2000s, feeling flush enough to say buy myself a second home, or feeling confident enough of my prospects in the future to take huge loans and actually purchase or consume much more than I can, I think the past 5 years have had a drastically sobering effect. I think for the 97, and I'm talking about the 3% right now, because that's what's built the city of Gurgaon. It's the 3%, it's not the 97. Although the 97 have actually constructed it. To answer your question, I feel that if the reason for that kind of reticence of not consuming comes from this perception and this nagging notion that that space that I'm occupying, do I own it? Is it mine forever? Is it something I can give my kids? Is it on lease? Is it going to be taken away? Is it a tenancy that's informal, illegal? What is it? I think that perception has grown. The idea that income is not guaranteed, it's that moving to a city doesn't mean a better life than the village. The idea that unemployment is now really the most, I mean, whatever we may see on mainstream media about what is going to drive this next election, I think by far across this country, the fact that the generation that is its most productive economically right now cannot see a future more than 2 years down the line has changed this idea of where I locate myself, where my home is, where do I feel secure. And as architects, we're constantly asked to respond to that. One of the big things talked about in Delhi is crime. And a lot of that crime comes from street crime. And that street crime comes from the fact that the streets are no longer considered spaces that belong to everyone and to you. So as long as I need to park my car in front of my gate, the street belongs to me. But beyond that, it doesn't belong to me. So once I'm in my car and zipping at 40 kilometers, it's a blur. these sorts of perceptions are undergoing change. I think those sorts of thinking, because you are seeing the negative impact of that on day-to-day lives in your own living conditions. So I think, yeah, if that kind of answers what you were.
Thank you.
I have a question which I don't normally ask in the beginning, but I think we're approaching some kind of Cinderella. I was curious because you state that you are an architect and not a planner, and yet most of your talk focused on your understanding about urban processes. In fact, your examples to start with were about urban morphology, really, urban form. And so I was curious as to why do you consider that as an architect you're not a planner? I mean, what's the difference? Is there a difference?
Yeah, there's a course. well, I didn't show any buildings because you told me not to. But to be serious, I think it comes from a sense of frustration. I think about 5 or 6 years into our practice, or maybe a little bit more, maybe even a decade in, by about 2011, 2012, both Vaibhav and I were frequently frustrated by what we could or couldn't do through architecture. The reason why I talk like a fake economist or a fake urban planner is because, or a fake geek, is also not a fake geek, a real geek, but a kind of fake technologist, is because I don't think it is good for architects to restrict themselves to their area of expertise in terms of the knowledge that they have. So I have tried over the past 7 or 8 odd years to keep myself informed about the kinds of things that I feel impact my practice of architecture. So what I tried to show or talk about today was bulk of that came from that kind of knowledge banking, as it were. I can't really point, I mean, without showing a building, I can't really show you how that has impacted how we go about the act of building. But I do know that as a practice, we are usually concerned about things that are outside the architectural program that is given to us as a brief from the client. We always try and see, okay, if this is the kind of program that is desired in this context, then what shape or form would that building take, and what would the insertion of that building in that context do to that context? So which is why that thing of urban planning, economics, history, these sorts of things kick into the practice. So I thought I'd be late for today's talk because I was on a con call that had to do with the Internet of Things. It's beginning to happen. We are getting into projects where it's not that is a demand being made on us. We are offering that as a form of dealing with space, augmented reality and virtual reality to various clients. It's right now early days. Usually they are clients with big wallets who can fund such expensive technology today. But I think that for me as a practitioner, it forces me to think about the reality of physical space much, much more carefully now, now that I'm getting involved in projects that involve AR and VR. I think the physicality of space is something that's, for architects, it will become much more precious, and we have to be much more careful about how we design. We can't do a slapdash job about it anymore, because what we are competing against is completely virtual in terms of what people perceive and how they receive feedback from their environment. So I think for us, it just makes our job that much, requires us to perform at a much, much greater, higher level than we are right now. So I'm looking forward to it. We've just started.